Y'all, it's Saturday night and things are about to get weird. I'm Caitlin McFarlane, co-founder of ATX TV Festival and the very lucky individual that gets to introduce our late night Saturday showcase of Ultra City Smiths presented by AMC Plus. While we can't wait to be with you again on some balcony in Austin, getting to know one another over a shared love of TV, we figured in the meantime, this could be a very good way to find out who's in and who's out. Personally, we were in the moment that AMC Plus asked and shared the following. Ultra City Smiths centers on the investigation into the mysterious disappearance of Ultra City's most famous magnate of two intrepid detectives. Wait for it. Using stop motion animation with baby dolls. What's not to love? To top it all off, it's created by Steve Conrad, who made the brilliant Patriot and Perpetual Grace Limited, which premiered at ATX a few years ago. This series will also reunite Steve with ATX alums, Jimmy Simpson and Luis Guzman, who are here tonight. One of my favorite festival memories was Luis singing karaoke with us. So that alone is reason enough to stick around. I'm going to pour a drink and let them get to it. But first, your moderator, Emily Aslanian of TV Guide Magazine.
Hey, everybody.
Have fun.
Awesome. So I'm going to kick this off by introducing the one and only Steve Conrad. He's the creator, executive producer, writer, and co-director of Ultra City Smiths. Thank you so much for joining us, Steve.
Yeah, thank you, Emily.
And next, we've got co-director David Brooks.
Emily.
We got Jimmy Simpson here, one of the amazing cast members. And we've got Hannah Mae Lee. Hey. We got Luis Guzman.
Hey, what's going on?
And lastly, we have Chris Conrad.
Yay. Hey, everybody.
Thank you all so much for being here. Obviously, the intro to this kind of laid out everything that's going on in the show, which is that it's completely bonkers and wild and weird. And I just love this world where I believe Dave is actually sitting right now. You have Ultra City behind you.
Yeah, Dave's right? In Ultra City.
Yeah, I'm here on set. We've got our miniature city behind us. We don't want to give away too much, but we figured we could sneak a little peek at Ultra City at its widest.
That is very cool. I want to get back to that in a sec, but first I have to ask Steve, what on earth were you doing when you came up with the concept for the show?
Well, I have wanted to work in animation for a very long time, and there's a tricky aspect to animation. It's getting an aesthetic. It's having the chance to create a show that doesn't look like anybody else's show, and it's harder than you think to have a look. So I had been fishing around for a way to present my writing and animation in some sort of new way. And while I was making Patriot, two of my very good friends worked in the art department, Jeff Dieter and Tom Glenn. And Jeff had been going to yard sales and buying baby dolls and then turning them into adults just to make art. And in his garage, there was just a world of characters, and I was hanging out with him. And I noticed that there was something about the aspect of a baby underneath an adult that drew out how needy and infantile and childish grown-ups are. So Jeff would have a baby doll character and give him male pattern baldness or a beer belly or a mullet. And instantly I could see all of the sort of weakness and the hunger that we all have to kind of childish hunger to be loved and cared for. And it seemed really strong to me. So Jeff and Tom and I just built it, and we built the world. And then AMC had the courage to allow us to go and build this city. So now we have, 100 characters in a full landscape of an urban setting. And we have very talented animators, and David is a tremendously talented director, and David's on the ground directing the animation there. So the world came alive, but all based on my friend Jeff, who was just doing it to make art.
How challenging was it to like pitch a show like this?
I know we made a prototype, so we had some film so they could see that this could work. One of the accomplishments of the show, though, is like they're, when you start to animate them, you can feel characteristics, but it's not until our actors deliver their performances that we can really start to see who these characters are. And I just got lucky beyond to have this group who I have worked with before. And it's just a labor, I hope, of love for them, but I think it's a testament to the quality of people that this cast is, ultimately, that they, all of them could be doing anything they want. And they take some of that time to help us create something that we hope is dynamic and new. And no one's really getting paid on this show. And these guys could be spending their time on vacation or making live action stuff that they love. So I have a tremendous amount of gratitude for them. And I think that adds up to just a really good feeling that this gang is sort of in this to make it, not to make anything else out of it.
Awesome. Now, I do want to talk about these characters a little bit more. Let's just go through all of our cast members that are here. Jimmy, if you'd like to start, I believe your Detective Mills is the first character that we might meet in this show.
Young rookie detective David Mills. He's got a life. He's spent most of his life upstate, removed from the city. And he's always been really drawn to the city for a variety of reasons that will come to life throughout this amazing series. But the initial, the actual practical pull that gets him there is this very, very wealthy, well-known socialite millionaire has gone missing. And Detective David Mills is just hungry enough and intrigued by the city enough that it becomes his personal mission to figure out what exactly has happened. It's a Steve Conrad production. And so I was blown away by the layers and layers that kept opening up. His storytelling in everything he does is profound and then hilarious. And you put those two things in stop motion, as you described, with baby dolls, with adult characteristics. And it's just, it's like a wonderland. I've always been obsessed with stop motion, not just like Harryhausen, but of course, Clash of the Titans. But then like Jan Svankmajer is a guy that I found a deep love for. And then, then they did Team America, and then they did, Charlie Kaufman did Anomalisa. And now it's Steve Conrad doing stop motion Steve Conrad style. And it's my favorite, version yet.
I love that. I feel like every time I talk to you, you always like fanboy, and I absolutely love that.
I can't help it.
It's so great. Tell me about these other characters. Hannah, could you tell me a little bit about who you're playing and how your character comes into play in the larger mystery at all? You can tease. I know we're a little far out.
I play Christina. Excuse me. I play my beautiful husband-to-be, Luis Guzman Rodrigo Smalls' character. And we're pregnant, very pregnant. And we're trying to get away from this city, this crazy city. But, maybe we'll go in a way that's a little bit less traditional. but my character's fun. I mean, she's just, that doll is crazy. She's like a baby pregnant baby doll. And she's just always by her husband's side or her fiance's side, but wanting to get out, always wearing like hip hop gear. I mean, she's pretty into all the fashions and glasses and long hair, and I went method with the stop motion. Like my hair is like down to my hips just to get ready for this character. So that was fun. But I mean, I agree with Jimmy. I mean, Conrad, like when you do a Conrad show, it's like you're getting in there for the Conradian experience. And with the little mouths moving with the baby dolls, it's just like incredible. And the story that he tells with just animation is just so amazing and crazy and so electric. And I'm really excited to see the baby doll with Rodrigo Smalls, with Luis's character, because he's pretty a big character in this. And, you know, we try to avoid Detective Mills over there, Jimmy's character, but doing whatever we can to get out of this Ultra City Smiths. But yeah, she's fierce. She looks dope, right, guys?
Yeah, I thought I could add to that. Thank you, Hannah. Ultra City is it's a lot like 1970s and early 80s New York City, and the crime is rampant, and the police are corrupt. So it's a dangerous town, and it's a very hard town, and all of our characters are struggling to try to stay safe and peaceful in this environment. Some of them do rough things, like Luis's character is a, kind of a neighborhood crime lord. But when we spend more time with them, we learn everybody's just trying to keep the ones they love safe. And Luis's character, I love so much because Luis sent me a picture of him when he was in his 20s, I guess. And he looks so badass. So we just built the doll around this picture. So awesome. This doll really is Luis.
That's so cool.
That's cool, man.
How was it to see yourself in doll form?
I thought, oh wow, okay, this is like taking my life to a new height, a new level, you know? And like Steve said, I sent him a picture. I think I was 17, 18 years old. I have this huge Sly and the Family Stone afro, nice. You know? That was the vibe back then. And, you know, let me tell you, man, Steve Conrad to me is an amazing visionary artist, you know, and he kind of just puts the stuff in front of you and you just take it and it nourishes you and you put it out there and he guides you through. You know, the whole stop motion aspect of the show, I mean, the earliest I ever remember was Davy and Goliath, you know? You know? And just to say, you know, I mean, we bleeped ahead technology-wise, but, you know, just the whole concept, the whole Ultra City Smiths. And like he said, you know, New York during the 70s and the 80s, you know, that's where I grew up, you know, that's where I went with my school of hard knocks, you know, and to be involved in something like this, especially with the cast, you know, all these cats that, you know, we did Perpetual Grace together and we had an incredible family. I guess we moved part of that family onto this thanks to, you know, Steve and his vision. So, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. And Chris, tell me about Nico. What's he all about?
Well, first I wanted to just say hi to everybody and tell everybody how great it is to see all these beautiful faces. And I think anybody that's a fan should know that these people are some of the best people I've ever come across. And it's just a pleasure to work with them, to see them, to smile with them again, and to make something as excellent as this is with everything Steve does. But this is just a real treat to be part of, especially given the last 2 years everybody went through to pull this off and come together. And so it's awesome. You guys all look great. I'm so excited to just be sharing anything with this whole extended family. But so just wanted to say hi and tell everybody it's wonderful to see y'all and be part of this again. Detective Nico Onassis is a sensualist. It's so beautifully described. I don't really even know where to start. I think he's just, he's sort of a hedonist and a sensualist and constantly distracted by both men and women and everything in general, other than trying to focus on his job and being a detective. And I think he's coming to a pretty serious crossroads when we see him, where he's starting to figure out that he's probably got he's probably on the downward slope here, and he's starting to fade. As Steve so greatly put it, he's on the fade now, where things are going to start slipping away from him if he doesn't sort of take stock. And one of the things I think he tries to figure out is if he can get married, it'll sort of give him an anchor where he can become a better detective. So that's one of the great sort of other storylines with the detective is I don't think he even knows yet who he wants to marry. He just knows he's definitely going to marry somebody soon and get this anchor so that he can become a better detective. And of course he saddles up next to Jimmy and they become partners, and it's just got this beautiful, crazy Starsky and Hutch element to it. And I don't want to give away too much, but like Louise said, it's just another, Steve Conrad production. So I think that says it all in terms of the scope of excellence you're going to get.
Now, I mean, you just kind of said it there. It's a Steve Conrad production, but it's still like a crazy concept. Did anyone have any doubts while reading these first scripts? Like, this is nuts, or just, it was like, I'm all in immediately.
All in, without a doubt. Yeah, absolutely. You have to turn the first page to know you're all in with something like this, and this cast, and this Steve, the quality that he comes at everything with is just, it sets the standard. So you're just like, yeah, when, where, however I need to be part of it, let me jump on in.
It's funny. It's the funny thing about Steve is he's created such high expectations in you because of everything he's done before this moment. And then the new moment comes, and yes, Steve Conrad's going to do stop motion. I can't wait. And then like, oh my God, it always beats your expectation. And this script blew me away from, like Chris said, just the first page, you're like, okay, he's inventing, and there's that Steve genius. And then it just keeps getting better and better. It's such a great story. I was so impressed.
It doesn't really read like stop motion, right, guys? Like, reading the scripts for the first time, so glad that, we chose this medium, but it just, a great story is a great story. This is, unique and wonderful, but the scripts stand alone as great story. And that's where it stems from, I think.
Yeah, there's nothing cartoonish. There's nothing stop motion about it. And but it gets to wash dolls.
I got an early preview of the script, since there's no video yet, which I'm very curious to see what the episodes are going to look like. But it was almost cinematic reading it. Were there any particular like films or anything in mind when you were writing this?
Absolutely. You'll notice in every episode we create kind of a tip of our hat to a film that we love. We build it into the show. So you'll if early into the show, you'll recognize the 70s landscape of cinema, Dog Day Afternoon. That's a hallmark for us. Midnight Cowboy is another hallmark for us. But it's a modern show. It doesn't take place in the 70s. And the city is a metropolis. It's like 10 New York cities. And it's got around every corner, there's a new sort of cinematic surprise. There's a Central Park and a prison and a red light district. And it became a real chore and a treat at the same time to, there's so much you take for granted in live action, like clouds, they're just up there, but we have to make our clouds and shoelaces and puddles. And it makes you think about clouds and shoelaces and puddles, the way characters walk. We have to find models for their walks and demonstrate those to the animators, because everybody walks different from everybody else. And the way you walk, it says something about you. In that respect, there's so many tools to tell stories with, but it's painstakingly slow. And well, that's where David comes in. David runs this crew where, you shoot, what would you say average on a set per day, time-wise?
Per day, per animator, we're averaging about 8 seconds of animated footage per day, per animator.
Yeah, so we have 40 different sets happening. So if you walk in there, there's 40 different cameras and 40 different worlds and two animators on a set. So it's this huge dynamic thing where everybody's working so hard, but you watch the dailies at the end of the day and it's 8 seconds and wow. You cross your fingers and go, wow. So I think this is working. We'll know later.
That's incredible.
Those late night texts I get from you, Steve, at the end of the day saying, man, the dailies are killer. It's just it's a highlight because we're working so hard all day to get that stuff out. And then you get to see it all together just as like a chunk of stuff, you know?
Yeah. And the other tricky thing is there's no do-overs. You have to get it right. That's it. So when you watch it, it's dyed in the wool. That's your show. These guys know part of what we do in Perpetual Grace is you watch it and scramble, we improve, we figure it out together, we can go back, we can kind of shuck and jive. On this show, everything has to be done first. And watching the dailies, it's a little nerve-wracking because you just know that's it. I mean, the most nervous I have been on this experience of Ultra City was directing Tom Waits. I didn't sleep for 2 days. That went very, very well. But the second most anxious I have been is every night when we watch dailies, I go, come on, man, come on. And then every night it clicks.
Literally, because it's like click, click, click.
When did you guys start like physically making the show? Like how long has it been since you got that first shot, David?
Oh man. Well, the green light was what, September, Steve?
Yes.
And then we do so much work before we even get on set. You know, we're building storyboards and animatics and scratch audio and you know, rough sound design and just kind of like getting everything lined up.
Writing the songs. It's a musical.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I forgot to mention that. Oh, right. So there's a song in every episode and Jimmy got the first one called The Wooden
Song. Oh, Jimmy sings?
Oh, yeah, he does. Yeah.
He kills it. Yes. He does great. This song's incredible.
I can't wait for Louis' song in season two.
Oh, season two, yeah. It'll be a cover.
Did Tom do any of the music at all, or is he just?
Oh no, I would not presume to ask Tom Waits. I can ask Jimmy Simpson to do a little number for us, but Tom, he recorded for 2 days, two wow. different sessions. So the first day, he's such a champ and a pro, but I mean he's Tom Waits, so just massive. Artist and I was surprised he came back the next day. I just couldn't believe it. I'm like, he's actually going to come back and keep doing this. And his rendition of our character, the narrator, is just so beautiful. Anyway, I am lucky to have this entire cast, but and Tom's included in that number for sure.
So designing this world, designing this city, and then you're recording 8 seconds a day. You guys started in September.
No, the show was greenlit in September, but we started shooting in January and I'll be out of here in July, early July. So
yeah, David's in Toronto. That's where Ultra City.
Yeah.
That's impressively quick for stop motion. I feel like that takes forever normally.
It is. We have 6 episodes. I hope I can say that. If not, we can just bleep that out. But we have 6 episodes and this is lightning fast speed. I mean, not just the 8 seconds a day per animator with 20 animators, but just getting to this point where we can be on set. And, you know, we have such a talented group of people, not just the animators, but Joe Passarelli, our director of photography, Josh Mahan, our art director, you know, stuff just looks absolutely incredible. And when we get it on camera and it ends up on screen, I think it'll show. We're trying to do the material service, you know, not just Steve's writing, but all the great acting. And, you know, it comes out, it really does show. And we have an opportunity to like let that talent shine through the animation and through the camera and lighting and through the production design. And it's pretty incredible.
Yeah, we have had a goal when we're executing it where we, you know, everybody remembers stop motion from their childhood. And it's sort of, it's just kind of embedded in your appreciation for stop motion is kind of embedded in your youth. So when you sit and watch it, even as adult, it harkens back to this time where things were very, very new to you. And these myths were flying in Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Frosty the Snowman. What David and I have tried to do is to create an R-rated world where our stop motion figures do all the things people do to each other in R-rated movies. But there's something about the magic of the movement that allows it to be kind of poetic and beautiful and a little deeper than if you were seeing, like when our figures make love, like you really have to, you got to think about all of the movements and you can't get anything wrong and it has to be right. So you can imagine the way you loved Rudolph when he finally won, right? Like he's flying, but he's stop motion flying. He's not really flying. And you think, well, okay, the power of that, the hard work to make that feel like flying, if you can do that with making love and shooting each other and fighting and crying and riding a motorcycle chopper, like there's really nothing that you can't do that can't cast a spell if you get it right. The art form allows for a lot of spell casting.
And I want to talk about the rest of the cast. There's such an enormously massive, amazing cast. I mean, we mentioned Tom Waits as the narrator, but then there's also like Divine Joy Randolph, John C. Reilly, Tim Meadows, Kristen Bell and Dax Shepard signed on. It's an
insane. Damon Harriman.
Yeah, I could go on and on. There's like the list on IMDb is crazy already, and it's only 6 episodes. So like, yeah. That is so impressive. Did anyone get to record together, or was that all done separately because of coronavirus?
No, everybody had to go one at a time because of the times. Yeah. Yeah. Even Dax and Kristen couldn't do it together. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah. But
Steve does great impressions, so he gets to read with the other actors, and he's like, I don't want to call you out on your Louis impression, but it's pretty solid.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'm a huge Luis Guzman fan, and I've had the honor of spending a year with him, and I got to watch him read my writing, which is one of the thrills of my life. Yeah, Luis and Ben Kingsley shared almost every scene together. And Ben, everybody knows that guy was born to act, but so was Guzman. Like those two toe-to-toe in their scenes, just on a daily basis. One of the highlights of my life.
But I gotta tell you, brother, it was an amazing experience to do that. I'll never forget like the first full day, not to take away from what we're talking about, but it was like, I messed up like the first two takes and I go to Ben and I say, I'm just warming up, buddy. Give it a second. But I gotta tell you guys, man, the anticipation that I have, I just can't wait to see what we did, man. Because again, this is like a whole different universe for many of us, you know? And Steve and the team that he's put together, like I said, I just can't wait to see what we're going to see, man, because I just know it's going to be brilliant, you know? So, yeah.
Awesome. Yeah, the story's so gorgeous, and it's just, you know, Steve's always outdoing himself, but it's just, you know, you're moving along and it's amazing. And then you're like, oh, look at these lines. And he starts pulling back and it's this connectivity that he is able to blend all of these characters. And then he keeps pulling back and you see like, oh my God, everything is connected. And he always pulls that off in his live action stuff, but you're just not quite used to that depth of storytelling when it comes to stop motion. And so, and I've seen just little clips of David's work, and the two combined, everyone is in for such an amazing treat.
Yeah, we're gonna start the world in a great way, man. And you know, the fact that I get to be Hannah Mae's partner. Yeah, girl.
get it.
I'm curious about the characters because this show is crazy. We've got a mystery going, we've got musical components of everyone that is here. Who thinks that their character is going to surprise viewers the most?
I can offer a guess.
Take it away.
Jimmy's character is just a bundle of need and emotion and power. Yeah, 40 different. Oh, there he is. He's got 40 different addictions. He's an orphan with a lot of baggage, and he's got a lot of demons, and in order to suppress his demons, he dances them down. So he spends a lot of time dancing to suppress his addictions.
Dancing and limbs, man. Dancing and limbs.
That's awesome. Well, I would personally be very creeped out if I had to spend all of my time in a dark room with those dolls, but I love it.
Yeah.
Well, when you get to know them.
Yeah, there's a sweetness that I think is across the board.
Across.
All of our characters.
It's crazy.
It's nothing to be afraid of.
But season 5, I think Rodrigo probably will surprise us all. Steve, what do you think? Yeah,
I love him. He's a good man in a hard town doing hard things mm-hmm. to keep someone he loves safe. And at the end of the day, he's got to choose. And we're going to be cheering for him to choose to protect the rest of our cast.
Awesome. Right. Well, I think that's all the time that we have for today. Thank you guys so much for hopping on here.
Thank you for making time for us.
Absolutely. Everyone go check out the first 2 episodes of Ultra City Smiths. They're going to be available on Thursday, July 22nd on AMC streaming platform, AMC Plus. Keep enjoying ATX Television Festival. It's going to be airing on Thursdays. Yeah, there's so much to love about this. There's just so much wild, bonkers stuff to come, and I can't wait for people to see it, myself included. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you, man. I love you guys.
Thanks. Thank you.
Love you guys.
I miss you guys.
See you guys.
Thank you all.